You know, I used to track the miles at the end of every run. I had this huge white poster board and everybody's name that I wrote in with a Sharpie and tried to draw straight lines across all of their names and put numbers at the top to represent the miles. At the end of each run, I would take a marker and I would color in how many miles everybody ran that day. So it was a cumulative total we were keeping track of. And when I got to one specific guy who ran with us and it was his turn for me, or his turn to be colored in, just would hover over me and watch me color in his miles for the day to make sure, one, I got him right, and two, that someone was giving him credit for the work that he was doing. And it was moments like that that help you realize everybody is the same. Right above this desire for food and water of Maslow's hierarchy of needs is this desire to be appreciated and valued and feeling important and cared for and respected and loved. Doesn't, you know, just think about your kids if you have kids, how much you make sure they know that. If they bring home a paper where they got an A on, you put it on the fridge. If they bring home a spelling quiz they did good on, you put it on the fridge. You want to make sure you know, they know that, that their work and that they're important to you. And that feeling does not go away when we get older. It probably gets stronger. That's the reason why people quit jobs. It's the reason why people quit friendships and relationships, because they don't get that from that business or from their boss or from their companion. And, you know, a light bulb goes off that if these guys in the shelter are missing that, are missing this emotional well-being about themselves, where they need to learn to be proud of who they are and understand everything that's inside of them and how to get that, I almost felt it was my responsibility. And if these guys feel this, what about all the other shelters in Philly where a program is needed like this to focus on making people feel good about themselves? That's a really important step, and you can't skip that when someone's trying to have a better life or make change in their life. And what about all the other shelters in the country? And this was sort of my, you know, pipe dream happening here. I was like a naive 26-year-old. But to me, it was really real, not only from a business perspective and seeing how a program like this of just offering support and love for people, how it changed their attitudes and behavior and their actions, but in a personal level, like, it was making my life make sense. You know, all the reason, I had no answer for why my dad was the way that he was, why he went through all of those struggles, why we had to go through all that hardship, why my life didn't work out the way that it was supposed to. I didn't know any of that. And having this happen and having so many things fall into place that, frankly, I'm just not that clever to plan. You know, the 5 weeks from Comcast to this idea happened in the summer. All these people were offering to help. You know, I'm not a very religious person, but there's something bigger going on there. And when things like that happen, you have to pay attention to it. And so I'm starting to think, maybe I'm supposed to build this and grow this and make this, you know, my full-time effort. So I'm talking to anybody who'll listen to me, like, can I do this? What should I do? And you know, most people are telling me to take the Comcast job and, you know, run with these guys in the morning and be fine with it. Like, what do you mean you don't want to go to Comcast? And there was maybe two people, and my mom was not one of them, who thought that this, you know, who thought that this could work. And I realized I could ask 100 people about what to do with my life, and I'm going to get 100 different answers. But doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. You know, I had to take a look around at this city and all the things that are created, and even the Comcast building. Someone had to say, I'm going to do this, or I have an idea and I'm going to execute it. That's how anything starts or anything happens. And those people who, you know, made me feel like one person can't change the world, again, there's no other way. One person has to say or do something for anything to be different or to change. And so I thought, what's the worst that could happen? Doesn't work out? Can I live with that? Yeah, I can live with that. But if I don't do it, I'm going to spend the rest of my life wondering how many people, you know, I maybe could have helped by giving this a shot. So had to call Comcast and have an uncomfortable conversation. Unfortunately, I didn't get the balls to do it till the day before, so that made it even better. And tell them, you know, thank you for the 5 weeks to really figure out what I needed in my life, and I need to take the rest of my life to fulfill this passion and my mission in this world. And such a supportive company, you know, I can't say enough about Comcast, and frankly, because their support has been so good to back on my feet now in all of our different markets. But, you know, I started building and learning and screwing up and fixing that, and then screwing up some more and fixing that, and walking into a situation where, you know, surrounding yourself with really smart people was one of the best pieces of advice that anybody can ever give you. But it's being, you know, okay with taking a risk on some of those things, and really proud of what Back on My Feet has become. It's not a running club, you know, it's a running-based program that Still starts with running 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday at 5:45. We have operations in Philly, Baltimore, DC, Boston, Chicago, Dallas, and Indianapolis. Once members make it through the first 30 days of our program, you then move into Next Steps, which is where we focus on who you are, why you're homeless. We have to understand why you got to this position, otherwise we can't help you. And those first 30 days are so important because it builds trust. People are starting to feel good about themselves after exercising, moving your body, and all this stuff just starts pouring out. We work with legal services, law firms to help our members with their legal issues. We work with job partners to employ our members. Accenture is a huge supporter of ours, creating a workforce development plan for our members. It's really this path to self-sufficiency, but we can't skip that first step. You know, Back on My Feet's a 6 to 9 month program where if people don't understand what they can do, their capabilities, their potential, and that their desire to want a better life for themselves, you can't force any of that stuff. And you can't skip those steps either. So I know there's time for Q&A here in a second, but there's tons of ways for you to get involved. I know not all of you are from Philadelphia, but Back on My Feet's expanding. You know, we're taking a little bit of break to upgrade all of our technology and get systems in place that need to be there. But we're expanding down to Atlanta in the fall, and we have grandiose plans to hopefully hit 7 to 10 new markets for next year. Including, you know, possibly Miami and New York and getting over to the West Coast. And it is our mission to be in every single city that needs this program. And for me, a really special part is not just helping individuals discover those capabilities, but it's the social change that Back on My Feet is a part of. You know, if I walked up here and asked you to give me a couple words to describe the word homeless or someone who's homeless, you might hear lazy or, you know, doesn't want to work. I ask kids this, they say smelly, doesn't have anything, you know, ripped clothes. There's so many negative stereotypes around homelessness, and it has a huge branding problem. And it is our, again, part of our mission to change that, to introduce you to some people who are going through it. You know, we don't say the words homeless people. It is people experiencing homelessness. Homelessness does not define who they are. It's a state of where their life is. And we build them up to bring up positive associations with themselves. They're runners, they're teammates. They're capable, they're dedicated. And that's a really important part, again, of our mission. And it's fun when we have volunteers come for the first time and they ask, you know, what do I say to these guys? What do I talk about? Can you give us some conversation starters? And it's like meeting anybody who you maybe met here today. What's the first thing you ask them about? You know, who do you work for? Where do you live? You have something in common now with someone in that morning. You're a runner. Is this your first time running? Have you ever done this before? You know, how long have you lived in Philly? Were you born here? Or whatever city that you're in. And at the end of those runs, you know, the volunteers start to realize that it's almost like a humanizing effect takes over, that why would I think I'm so different from somebody because he doesn't have a home and I do. And you realize again that there are many differences between us, me and Darren, as you saw up there. Darren's black, I'm white, he's older, doesn't have an education, Darren's done more drugs than anybody possibly should in his life, he's been in jail a few times. I've almost been arrested for curfew, but that's the extent of my running with the law. And we're very different, and we didn't focus on any of those things. We focused on the things that we have in common. Darren's hilarious. He's funny. He makes you laugh. He has a great outlook on life. And you start to, again, look at those things that we have in common and realize that if we can just put our differences aside and help each other, that's how you make the world a better place. That's how you make your neighborhoods better, your communities better, for having the empathy and understanding that people are different. Everybody can grow up in North Dakota and have a bike and could play till midnight. You know, Mike, another one of the members in the program, grew up watching his brother sell drugs on the corner. That is what his reality was. And shame on us for condemning people who didn't have privileges that we have. It's not fair and it's not right. And we can't judge somebody for being born into a situation that they didn't choose. Anyway, now I'm going on a tangent. So before I sit up here and, like, you know, get on my soapbox for the next 2 hours, I'm just going to stop and see if anybody has questions. I know I didn't elaborate a lot on the program, and I know the concept just seems kind of weird to people sometimes. So if you have questions, I'm delighted to answer them.